Hello, my dear friends, this is Paquito again. We have at the Pac-Man's Corner a person that is very special for all of us, for all people that love jazz music, people who love music in general, but mainly jazz music. And he was even the person who inspired the name of this program of mine, the Pac-Man's Corner. He was the founder of a wonderful club in San Francisco called the Keystone Corner. And in 1983, my manager Helen Kim programmed me to play a whole week there, and I recorded an LP, which is, that is the cover of that LP at the Keystone Corner. welcome my very, very dear friend, Todd Barkin. Hello, Todd. How are you doing these days? I know you're doing well.
Well, I'm staying busy, trying to make the world safer, Bebop.
I love that. Oh, man. I was remembering my days at your wonderful place. I remember that the week before, it was Woody Shaw and his quartet. And he stayed during the entire week that I spent, almost the entire week that I stayed at the Keystone Corner. And the following act was Archie Shepp. Do you remember that?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Double bill.
Oh, it was a double bill, right?
Yeah. Yeah, Woody Shaw and Archie Shepp. It was unbelievable.
Amazing place, amazing atmosphere in that club. You know, so many people come to see me. I was a little nervous, you know, because it was my first tour in the West Coast.
Right.
But then the culmination of all that was the Keystone Corner. Tell us something about the creation of that club.
I was a young musician out in San Francisco. I had come there from Oberlin College, which is a college in the Midwest, and I drove out in a 1941 Cadillac in 1967 to San Francisco, and I played in a Latin jazz band called Quani and the Quanditos. And I played electric, you know, the early Fender Rhodes pianos like Joe Zawinul and Les McCann.
And tell me something, who's that Quanti?
Quanti. He was a black American guy who loved Mongo Santa Maria. He was actually originally from Nigeria.
No kidding. And he played with percussion?
Yeah, he played the conga drums. And we had three horns, piano, bass, and drums. And sometimes guitar, and we had dancers. Sometimes, a few times, we had girls with no clothes on in Golden Gate Park. And we, you know, it was very rudimentary. A lot of Mongo's music.
It looked like you were having lots of fun in that group, huh?
Oh yeah, we played almost every night. We played the Mongo Santa Maria covers mainly. And at that time, I was looking for a gig for the band, and I went to this beer bar in North Beach, and I said, hey, you should hire Quani and the Quanditos on Monday night. Free spaghetti. We'll take 60% of the door. He said, well, I don't know if that'll work. He said, well, this is a bar with just beer, and jazz people like wine and booze. You know, I don't think that'll work. But why don't you buy the club? You can hire your own band. Because I'm going to open a big rock club in Berkeley. And I need some money. And I had saved up about $8,500. So he said, well, come back here on Thursday. We'll see what we can do. I got to get this club by Friday or I'll blow the deal. So I came in Thursday with a friend of mine and my little checkbook. And he said, okay, I need a check. He knew how much money I had because I told him. So he said, I need a check for $5,000 down. And then I need another check for $750 to transfer the beer license. And he sold me the club for a total of $12,500, $5,000 down and $400 a month. And at the age of 25, I was a jazz club owner.
Wow. It's not America or what?
That, and all of a sudden, I had no experience owning a business, running a bar, nothing. You know, I just love music. So I was a jazz club owner at the age of 25.
And this is happening what year, you say?
That was 1972. That was 11 years before I was going to meet you.
Wow.
That's what they call me, Arn Blakey. Music, it's alive, it's a living thing. It's like a river, it's got to flow, it's got to keep flowing. ¶¶ eyes are the windows of the soul. And we look at each other and we can tell. I'm hitting certain things on the drum while I'm just back there directing the traffic, which way to go. That's what makes so much fun in playing jazz. It's different every night. You can't hear the same arrangement twice to save your neck because it's different. It's the way we feel at that time we play the music, and the audience are 70% of it because they are the ones who make us feel good. Three blind mice, and we improvise on it. You know, we do. You know, just put a little thing in it, you know, and just like kids would do when they were jumping rope or something. Any tune, if it's a good tune, it's the way it is built, you can turn it into march time, to waltz time, to any time. Jazz. That's what I play, what I call polyrhythms. I mix them all up together. Just as long as they come together and they swing, and they will swing. You know, it doesn't matter where the beat is. This is a team, this is a band. We have no stars. The star is the whole band. So we all work together. We all need each other. Music is just a wonderful thing, and it's good medicine. It's really good medicine. I don't care how sick I am. I have a temperature 105, 106, I don't care. If I get to my drum and get to the bandstand, bash, after the first note, that's it. And I never know how I feel that day until I hit the first note, because the adrenaline comes up and you're just playing, and whatever sickness it was, it's gone. You're really playing from your heart. You strip, people can see clean through you, and especially children. They can look clean through you. And whatever is in your heart will come out on the bandstand if you're playing music, especially jazz. Create your own identity. That's the most important thing, is creating your own identity on any instrument. kids from all over the world write letters, send me pictures and tapes, because someday they want to play in the Jazz Messenger. Job to go up there and make people feel good. This is the idea about jazz. This is the wonderful thing about it. This is what makes jazz the eighth wonder of the world, because we don't know what we're gonna play. No music, from the creator to the artist to you. Split second timing.
Okay, Tuck, now I know, but I want you to tell the people, our audience, what is all about that name, the Keystone Corner in San Francisco?
Well, the Keystone Corner is located next door to the police station. And in the old days, there were British Max Sennett comedies called the Keystone Cops, but it was spelled K-O-P-S.
Yeah.
So we named the club after the Keystone Cops, and it's right on the corner for the police station, so it became the Keystone Corner with the K. So, because of the old Keystone Cops, they would drive around like crazy and bump into each other. They were called the Keystone Cops. They were kind of like a Laurel and Hardy of police. So the Keystone Cops became the Keystone Corner with two Ks. So it's named because of its unique position right next to the police station. And we were very lucky that we became good friends with the police. So then they were like guardian angels for the club while it was around. So that's it got its name by being right next door to the police station in North Beach in San Francisco.
Well, and I was so impressed by that name, and I called my program the Pac-Man's Corner.
It's a real compliment. It makes me feel like we have a legacy.
Tell us now about the Keystone Corner in Baltimore. How comes that you open again there? Because it's a wonderful club. The food is so good, and the atmosphere, the piano is always in tune. Wonderful place. Tell us the story of the new Keystone Corner, please.
Well, it almost happened as far out as the original Keystone Corner, because I wound up coming to New York, where we continued our working relationship all these years. We're in our fifth decade or so working together. So we worked together at Jazz Lincoln Center, and then I got an award called the NEA Jazz Masters Award, which you have too. We're fellow jazz masters, you and I, Paquito. NEA, National Endowment of the Arts Jazz Masters. So it was in Washington in April of 2018, and the host of the dinner, or the awards dinner, was a famous restaurateur who owns the greatest French restaurant in D.C. called Marcel's at the Kennedy Center. And we met, and our wives became good friends, and we became good friends. And so as we got to know each other, even after the ceremonies and after everything, we decided we wanted to work together and say, let's have a place with the best food and the best music in the world. Maybe if you look at this place, maybe and they haven't had a jazz club in over 30 years in Baltimore. So maybe you could take it over and we'll call it the new Keystone Corner. And we'll bring jazz to Baltimore and revive this place that's been closed for a year. In April of 2019, Keystone Corner Baltimore was born. And Ron Carter came, and a guy named, this guy I knew named Paquito de Rivera, he came and played there. And we had a new jazz club called Keystone Corner Baltimore. And it has 240 seats, and it's a beautiful room, and we play jazz films, and it has great food. And then we were just taking off in January 2020. We were just really, we were starting to be full every night, and all of a sudden, this latest development came along. So we got another challenge to get over, but we're doing our best.
Something about the GoFundMe campaign, you know, to help the Keystone Corner to stay alive. Are the people responding to that or what?
Well, they're starting to respond. I mean, it's being in Baltimore, we're a little, you know, under the grid, but we're starting bit by bit to get more and more people involved in the GoFundMe campaign. We've had a few hundred people contribute, so we're just launching it right now. We're in the middle of launching this GoFundMe campaign, which is used all over the world, you know, for people to help themselves by their bootstraps and have their friends. So we're really trying to reach out and reach more and more. We had some wonderful people give us endorsements, like Cindy and Carlos Santana and Benny Golson and Bill Charlap and Ron Carter and Warren Wolf and Joe Locke, and all kinds of people have given us endorsements. So that's helped us get the word out, but we're still in the middle of just really launching it and getting it out to people so that we can raise money to, you know, for the future. It's to build a bridge, because we're still going to have some challenges for the next 6 to 8 months. We are very fortunate here in Baltimore that we're being allowed to reopen just partially. We have been open for about, out of the 9 months, we've been lucky that we were been able to open a little over 4 months during that period with very limited audiences. So we don't really break even, but at least we're keeping the fire lit. You know, we're keeping it going with broadcasts and some contributions and this GoFundMe campaign. So we're in it, you know, we're committed. You and I, Paquito, are lifetime soldiers. You know,
we have no choice. We love this music.
That's right.
It's been the soundtrack to our lives. Sounds of freedom. Surviving decades of struggles. Expressing emotions from pain to sheer joy.
Jazz has survived so many struggles.
It has. Jazz has gone through everything that we've gone through as people. I mean, all of our highs, all of our lows, it expresses it with the note B flat, the note E, all of that, you know. And it's an honor to perform it. It's an honor to tell that story.
Ain't no power like the power of the people.
The most recent stories, the death of George Floyd and calls for justice, and a pandemic that has devastated minority communities, taking with it music legends emblematic of that struggle. For Sean Jones, jazz isn't just a profession, it's personal. Yes, he tours, but he also teaches.
Bo-bop-bop, right?
Preserving the legacy of jazz here at the Peabody Conservatory, located not far from Baltimore's famous jazz district, where clubs like Keystone Corner are usually booming with bent and blue notes. But for now, coronavirus has redefined jazz's call and response.
We've lost now more than a dozen jazz greats to COVID-19, many more within the jazz community.
Yeah, we've lost a lot of heroes. And I heard a quote the other day that every time you lose a legend, you lose a library. Just speaking to those folks, just hearing the stories, what's gone down over the years, hearing their songs, we can never get that back.
That's because Sean either knew or shared the stage with every legend lost to coronavirus. Grammy-winning virtuoso Wallace Roney, pianist and composer Ananje Ellen-Gums, even the great Ellis Marsalis.
Take a look at that list of musicians there. And as you look at those names, tell me what goes through your head and your heart.
Wow, joy and sadness all in one. I'm looking at my mentors. I'm looking at my friends. I'm looking at inspiration. I'm seeing stories. I'm seeing Bootsy Barnes in Philadelphia when I was a grad student, and I would go up trying to play Cherokee, and he would tell me how sad I was. I hear Ananje's voice on the phone when I recorded a song called Allison, telling me that I have integrity because I didn't play a solo until the very end. And I see Lee Konitz walking into Dizzy's Club Coca-Cola just to hang out and eat a cheeseburger. And gosh, Ellis Marsalis. I see myself with a group of young musicians in San Francisco after we just left the stage, and him telling us stories about when he struggled in New Orleans trying to play music in the 70s, and now we get a chance to play in this big, beautiful hall.
Rich stories that might have never happened. You see, there was another deadly virus that struck the jazz community more than 100 years ago, the 1918 influenza pandemic. It tore through New Orleans, and by some small miracle, there would be a 17-year-old musician who would survive it. His name was Louis Armstrong.
What would have happened to jazz if Louis Armstrong died in that pandemic?
Wow. What would happen if salt was never part of the equation of food? You wouldn't know food the way that you know it now without that element, without salt. Louis Armstrong is the salt of jazz. He's the foundation. So imagine something that important not existing. Would you have elements of the music? Sure you would, but that spirit wouldn't be there. It'd be a completely different thing.
And jazzmaster Todd Barkin should know. The legendary club owner, jazz curator, and Grammy-winning record producer has seen it all, but never anything like COVID-19 and the impact on these musical masters.
They were great teachers and reachers and preachers in our music, and their message is always with us. I mean, we have to live what they imparted to us. We have to, you know, live their lesson, or we're not doing our job.
For Sean Jones, keeping alive the roots and the rhythm is more than a passion; it's a calling.
As a musician, it is my duty to tell the story of COVID-19 sonically, to express the pain that folks are feeling right now, to express the tears that are shed, the anger, the loneliness, the depression. Jazz is gonna get us through this in the way that it always has. It's gonna allow us to be who we are, unapologetically. It's gonna allow us to cry. It's gonna allow us to talk to our neighbors again, to dance. That's what jazz is going to do. That's what all music is going to do. It's going to help us survive.
The nice things we do at the Keystone Corner, you know, I work with Paquito also on the jazz cruise, and I was there for many years playing jazz videos, and I built up a collection of thousands of jazz videos, and we play them here in the club. I mean, that's one of the features, and you've inspired me from the first time I heard you, and bless his soul, rest his soul, Claudio Rodici. Hojici.
Claudio Rodici.
You know, I said, what is this guy Paquito? He brought Lee Morgan with him in the band. These guys, what's this?
Playing the valve trombone too.
Right.
Beautifully, that valve trombone. I think it was the first time that he recorded with the valve trombone was in that LP, Life at the Keystone Corner.
Right.
I was very happy that I brought with me to the Keystone Corner at that time, and we recorded there. That was the idea of Helen King. We have to give credit to Helen that she said we have to go and record in Todd's place. She was right. Helen King was right. Remember that?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
That's a beauty. That's yeah. Daniel Ponce.
Daniel Ponce.
Paquito, Brenda, and Helen King.
Helen King. She was the person who planted the seed of our long friendship. Todd Barker.
Right, she planted the seed, and it was part of it. You know, our music is all about living history and living legacy. You were part of a continuation, a historical chain, because 3 years before you, Bill Evans recorded his last 16 CDs live at the Keystone. They were released.
Yes.
And Helen was a part of that too, because, you know, Helen was managing you and Bill Evans.
And Art Farmer.
And Art Farmer, yeah.
Now this, I realize that I never really talked about Helen King in a, you know, publicly. And she was responsible for so many jazz connections, you know. And one of them was with you at the Keystone Corner.
Right, right. She was, you know, Helen was a very important person in our music.
Ladies and gentlemen, 2018 NEA Jazz Master Todd Barkin.
You know, we're all partners in time, and this music makes time our friend, not an implacable foe. Our music makes time an endowment, not a stress-inducing limitation. In the early 70s, when Dexter Gordon used to come back to my office after selling out three sets on a Friday or Saturday night, he used to love to say to me, "Hey, Toddsy, I think we paid the light bill tonight." I was definitely overly idealistic and overly utopian. No, I really didn't know what I was doing when I opened Keystone Corner, except that I loved jazz. Then I moved back here in 1983. Between 1985 and 1990, I started managing the Boys Choir of Harlem. Well, working with kids has to be one of the greatest experiences you can have as a musician. You could be affecting the rest of their lives. The main job of a jazz recording producers create as nice an environment for the music as you can create, artistically putting together a program. And so I started working with Chico O'Farrell on his comeback record in 1995-96. And then I got to work with Babel Valdez, and then I got to work with Arturo O'Farrell, Chico's son, and even Arturo O'Farrell's children. Lo and behold, I wind up starting to work with jazz at Lincoln Center at the turn of this century. Now I wind up helping to start Dizzy's Club Coca-Cola. It's a wonderful environment for our music. It's one of the greatest jazz clubs ever created, physically and artistically. My feeling about jazz music is that it's a cycle of shared creativity. And when a musical environment is at its best, there's a really a strong feeling going back and forth between the artist and the audience, and they're feeding each other very integrally. Because jazz is about is telling your own story in your own way. That's the essence of what our music is all about.
Probably I never had the chance to tell you how proud we are of having you as a friend and to be associated with you from the very beginning of my career as a American musician, you know. And we really admire your work at the Keystone Corner in San Francisco through the wonderful job you did in jazz at Lincoln Center, and now with the Keystone Corner, Baltimore. So I hope that we have you and Eileen, your beautiful wife, for many years in the jazz business, because we need people like you. So, yeah. Todd, we are very happy to have you here, and I hope the next time I see you is on the stage or in the dressing room or the Keystone Corner, eating that beautiful food and listening to the High Lows or Charlie Parker or something like that.
And Paquito, you've always meant a lot to me.
Hello, Keystone family. This song's a prayer for the love we could share and the questions and the answers that are always there. Take care of the music and it will take care of you. We look forward to seeing you so soon here at Keystone Corner. Our hearts and our souls depend on it, and we love you very, very much, and we always will. Thank you for being part of the Keystone Corner family, and we look forward to seeing you very soon. Here's our song for you. Thank you.